Thank you for tuning in to another episode of Time Traveler's Handbook. Today we are going to be finishing off our conversation on Doctor Who, talking about the methods and rules of time travel to hopefully put a cap on how the universe works in Doctor Who. So for this episode, I would like to primarily just go through the different methods and rules that exist for time traveling. The Doctor Who universe has no shortage of different methods that have different effects on the universe depending on how they are used. We've discussed at length that there are a couple of rules to time travel. First, that you can't interact with a previous version of yourself, and second, that you can't travel to the same time as a time you have already experienced. Following these two rules prevents key events in your own life from being broken, which would cause a paradox and most likely destroy the timeline as you know it. The system is mostly non-deterministic with a few exceptions, which means that almost any key event can be changed and result in a branching timeline that you now exist in. Only time travelers affecting events have the luxury to change events that happen, which means that if you're a normal person living your life, it is not possible to change your fate without the assistance of time travel or someone else time traveling. The first and most prominent method of time travel in the Doctor Who universe is the classic time machine. We see many iterations of this, but the TARDIS is the best example, being a ship that can transfer you from one point in time and space to another. A recurring time machine that we also see is the vortex manipulator, which is a more crude way of traveling but will perform essentially the same function. Some of the alien species in the show have the ability to time travel, with the Weeping Angels from Blink being the most unique example, as they are not able to time travel themselves but rather make other people they touch travel in time. You can think of this as sort of an energy release that is used to send them through time that establishes the link between the Weeping Angel and the victim, such that they can feed off of the potential time energy that would have been spent on the rest of their lives. As we discussed in a previous episode, this introduces some deterministic elements to the universe because it is guaranteeing a fate of someone who is transported back in time. Other alien species that can time travel most often do it through similar time machines to what we've discussed previously, and don't have a lot of unique things to say about them. Occasionally, we get portals or time windows constructed that lead to a specific time-space coordinate. This is what happens in The Girl in the Fireplace, with the clockwork droids building windows into the life of a royal in France. The connection to this time and place is skewed by the amount of time the portal has been open. So as long as it is left open, the future moves further and further ahead on the other side of the connection. This is because if the portal led to exactly one time, any second use of that connection would violate the rule that you cannot travel to the same place you traveled to before, and thus all portals of this nature must continuously move forward in time for as long as they are active. So this is a method to have kind of a gateway between one point in time and space while still following the rules of the Doctor Who universe. The final way of time traveling I'd like to talk about, or at least affecting other time periods, is using a connection that connects to the time stream itself. We have multiple examples of this with the parting of the ways, with the Bad Wolf having the ability to spread words throughout the timeline of the Doctor to lead him to this end. Or we have Journey's End with the Reality Bomb having the ability to erase all of the history of the targets by having access to their entire timeline and destroying every point at once. And then we have the Name of the Doctor introducing the idea of an individual's time stream that one can simply step into and appear in any moment of that person's past as they're spread throughout it. This type of time travel typically ends up being deterministic, as the events that they are affecting have already happened to the people they are affecting, and thus they must not have already affected their past in order to not violate any rules. A great example of this is that we do see the words Bad Wolf spread throughout the past of the Doctor in that first season, or we see Clara appearing in multiple iterations in the past of the Doctor in that season. So this is yet another way to make a sort of deterministic system with time travel. And with all of this, I would say that we visited all of the possible areas that we could in attempting to define what the universe of Doctor Who is like. It took us only 65 episodes to get to this point, having visited many relevant episodes of Doctor Who one at a time. Of course, Doctor Who has many other episodes, and I just cherry-picked the ones that I thought would have the most impact. It's been a real experience going through all of the Doctor Who episodes and seeing what kind of ties them all together. Before I started this, I thought that there were kind of arbitrary rules set in place for whatever was convenient for the time that the episode was released. But as I explored further, I can see that there really are consistent rules that apply to the entirety of Doctor Who. It's interesting to me that there's this element of key events that don't really have a defined severity to them for if they can be changed or not. Because with that, you've defined a universe that you can be flexible with, depending on the impact that that would have further in the future. I hope you enjoyed these episodes as much as I enjoyed making them. We'll see you in the next episode. As always, thank you for listening.